Everybody. And when I use the word everybody, I use the term loosely. So it's they only let me do announcements when there's less than 25 people in the room, so the impact is. But this morning, in a comfortable surrounding, you didn't have to wipe snow off your car. Over. So, yeah, we're doing announcements from the stage this morning, so I'm not in anybody's backyard or car, so it'll let a little bit less exciting. So just a hand go over this morning. Hamilton County Harvest Food Bank, we have 5 Sundays to get those barrels filled. Fill them as many times as we want because they'll take them. We've got a list of the preferred items that they're looking for. So let's do the best we can to bring as much food as we can and to help out those folks that are in need. Tonight at 6 o'clock, the masks on and socially this morning. Men's breakfast continues on. We last Friday at 7 a.m. right here at the church. So not this coming Friday, but the following. It's an every 2-week deal. 7 a.m., and they're working their way through the Gospel of John. This morning, we're going to be in for the last in the sermon series, Proverbs, and then for those of you who like to look ahead, we're going to be looking at royal failures next. So if you're intrigued, royal failures is the next sermon series topic, and we'll get into that next week. Before we pray this morning, before we start our service, I'd like to open with a word of prayer. Gather today around your name, we pray that we would fill your hearts, our minds, and our souls. Transform us, Lord, and make us more like you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, amen. O Lord, our God, we gather together today to give you and praise your great. Your Son, Jesus' name we pray.
Away from the lion and towards the chicken, or would you run away from the chicken and towards the lion? What would you do? You would what? I can't hear you. Can you speak up? You'd use a key if you were trapped. That's okay. That's a good idea. What if you were standing between and there was a chicken over there and a lion over there and you had to go one of those directions? Would you go towards the chicken or towards the lion? Towards the chicken? Why would you go towards the chicken? Because they're nice? Yeah, and they're little? Yes. I've got to share that with everyone because that was a great, great point. He would not run towards the chicken because lions also like to eat chickens, and then the lion would chase both of them. And so he would fake towards the chicken, the lion would run, and then he would run out the other door. So this guy's a thinker. This guy's a thinker. That was a great, great, great idea. All right, what if you were given the choice between staying in your bed, having to stay in your bed all day long, or going somewhere fun, like the beach or the pool or a park? What would you pick? The beach, right? You probably wouldn't want to stay in your bed all day, would you? One at a time. Yeah. You did. That's awesome. All right. What if you had to choose between making God happy or making a friend happy? What if your friend was wanting you to tell a lie, and not telling a lie would make God happy, but not telling a lie would make your friend unhappy? Which would you choose? Would you make God happy or your friend happy? You wouldn't tell a lie, right? You would make God happy and not your friend. Okay? We should always choose God because he's the best thing for us. God made you for himself. All right. What matters more than anything in the whole wide world is what God thinks of you. It's more important than your house, your clothes, your food, how you spend your time, all of it. What God thinks of you is the very most important thing of all. So if you have to pick between doing what God says and doing what someone else says, we should choose God every single time, even if it makes you stand out, even if other people think you're weird for doing it. But what other people think still matters. God tells us to love our neighbors, and we can't love our neighbors. We can't love anybody if we don't care at all what they think about us. And if we're responsible for telling other people the good news about Jesus, then it's important that other people want to listen to us. Yes. I'm not sure, buddy. All right, 1 Corinthians 10:33 says this. It says, "Follow my example. I try to please everyone in every way. I'm not looking out for what is good for me. I'm looking out for the interests of others. I do it so that they might be saved." When what we want most is to make God happy, we will end up caring about others because God cares about others. God cares about people. He cares so much that he sent his son Jesus to die to save us from our sins. And if we care most what God thinks, then we will quickly realize that God thinks we should love our neighbors, and we should even make great big sacrifices for them. After all, that is exactly what he did. So we should always choose to make God happy. We should always be worried most about what God thinks. But we also need to remember that what makes God happy is when you and I care for other people. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this morning, for the opportunity to be here, gathered together. Even if it is a smaller group, thank you. At this point, we are able to live stream and provide ways to still have some kind of togetherness, even though we're apart. Thank you for these kids and for bringing them here, and for the other children that are a part of this church. Help us to raise them up in godliness. Help us to give them the words and the ideas and the language that they can build a good and sturdy faith on for the rest of their lives. Help us to just remember to worry about what you think most, God, and to find lots of peace and joy and happiness and knowing that what you think is settled. It's already figured out because of what Jesus did. Because of Jesus' death, you look at us and you see us as clean. You see us as your sons and your daughters, and you love us. And that's not anything that we do. It's what's been done for us. Even still, God, we should obey, and we should love you and serve you, and we should try our best to show that love that you have for us to other people. And so when we worry most about what you think, when we care most about doing what pleases you, help us to not be selfish, but to love other people as well. Thank you for this time that we have together. God, I pray that each one of us, not just our little ones, but all of us would be shaped by your word this morning and changed by the Holy Spirit working in us and on us and through us. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You guys can go back and take your seats. Well, as I change over my notes here to Romans 12, 1 and 2 as we move into our time of communion and offering. Romans 12, 1 and 2 says this. It says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. So how do we transform our minds? Well, we transform our minds with new and better information, but we also transform our minds through our environment. That's what I want us to think about with communion this morning. I've been involved with the sport of wrestling since I was, I think, 9. If you aren't familiar with wrestling, just know it isn't the kind of wrestling you might find on cable TV. There are no rings, there are no ropes, there are no microphones, and there are no ladders. The important thing for my illustration this morning is that you know there are weight classes in wrestling. In order to compete in, say, the 100-pound weight class, you have to weigh less than 100 pounds. If you are even 1 ounce over that weight, you will not be able to compete. And as a result, I learned over the years how much I could and couldn't eat if I was going to make weight the next morning. Not only that, but I learned by paying attention which foods would actually give me energy and which foods would make me just want to lay on the floor. Water is good. Soda is bad. Vegetables are good. Half a gallon of ice cream is bad. One sloppy Joe is good. 4 sloppy Joes, very bad. And there is a very sad story with that that I can't tell this morning. It wasn't, and it still isn't, terribly complicated. But I went from paying little to no attention at all to my food, basically eating what tasted good, to eating what was good for me. But it's not enough to just know this information. Anyone can pick up a book on weight loss, learn a thing or two about calories and carbs. Shoot, you don't even need to pick up a book. You can just type it in Google and read for 5 minutes and learn a thing or two about calories and carbs and weight loss, but never put any of it into practice. And if you're trying to learn how to choose apples over M&Ms, never buying apples and keeping a jar of M&Ms on your counter is a terrible strategy. My parents didn't buy things like Oreos during wrestling season because, as a teenage boy, I would have eaten all of them in half an hour. We are commanded in Romans 12, 1 and 2 to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. And so we do things like we read God's word, we pray. We are shaped by the Holy Spirit as he works in us and through the lives of our fellow believers when we're gathered together. But we also have to put ourselves into situations to be transformed. We have to show up. We can't just think about reading the Bible. We have to do it. We can't just think about praying. We have to do it. We're going to have a hard time reading our Bibles if it's not at hand. This is part of what we do with communion every single Sunday. Is we show up. We know we should obey God. We can go through the week knowing that's true. We can go through the week knowing that we're sinners. We can know these things, that Christ has died for our sins so that we could be forgiven. But it can be easy, really easy to forget. And so we come here and we take this bread and we take this cup and we pause to remember amidst the craziness of our lives that Jesus Christ died for you. He died for me, and he conquered death in his resurrection. We will never be transformed if we don't give ourselves opportunities to put what we know into action. If we stay away from church and we prioritize other things, if we want to eat apples but only give ourselves M&Ms, we shouldn't be surprised when we fail. But just showing up, being here on a Sunday morning, helps to transform us. It helps to put us back into perspective of what we're doing through the week. It reminds us of what I mentioned a moment ago, that Jesus died for my sins and that I ought to live like it, that we ought to live like it. Now, in a moment, we will come forward. Everyone here is a familiar face, so we know the drill. Christians can come forward. You don't have to be a member of Prairie View. We just ask that you be a follower of Jesus. The bread and the cup are here to be taken on your own, in your time, as well as the black boxes up here on the tables for an offering. But we just, in this time, I guess, want us to just remember what God has done and realize that this little act of taking communion can be a huge step in our life of faith. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you that you meet us where we are. But as you meet us where we are, you don't leave us there. You call us out of it. And not only do you call us out of it, but you yourself give us the strength to get out. You give us the Holy Spirit. You give us power through your body, through other Christians, through the word spoken as it moves in our hearts and moves us to take those steps. God, thank you for your Son. Thank you for the sacrifice he has made for us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Help us, not just with communion on Sunday mornings, but absolutely here to remember that. But help us take this small step with us, that we would put ourselves into situations to act on what we know, that we would put ourselves into situations to be transformed, that we would put ourselves into situations where we can act on what we know to be true, whether it's taking the bread and the juice and being reminded of that, loving our neighbors, whatever that case might be. Father, you know our hearts, and you love us still. And this communion, this offering, this sacrifice, this righteousness and justification and being made clean is available to any and all who believe. Thank you for the free gift of your Son and the joy and the peace and the hope that we find with him. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And you guys can come forward at your own leisure.
again. Welcome to Prairie View Christian Church. As we mentioned in our announcement earlier this morning, our live streaming capabilities turn out to be helpful for more than just a pandemic. So thanks to those people who are still tuning in, even if you plan to be here this morning and you didn't feel like getting out and driving, we're glad that you can still find a way to be a part of things. So today is our fifth and final week of examining problematic proverbs. Our first week was the phrase, "You only live once." Second was, "The Lord helps those who help themselves." Third was, "If you don't have something nice to say, don't say anything at all, Tom." And last week was, "Follow your heart." Each of these pithy, folky sayings of cultural wisdom have bits of truth in them that Christians can agree with and Christians can embrace, but they also contain problems that Christians should think twice about and maybe even avoid. That's also true of today's example, and today's example is the phrase, "Don't worry about what other people think." So go ahead and open your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 5. We'll be in a few different areas of Scripture this morning, but we'll spend a pretty good amount of time in 1 Corinthians. And with some of the technical difficulties we're having for those at home, it may be especially important for you to follow along in your Bible rather than relying too much on your screen. But before we do any reading, let's pray together. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for this time that we have together. Thank you for a mild winter up to this point with very few issues as far as weather goes and the ability to gather here in the room and worship after so many absences of the previous year. Lord, thank you that we can do that today. Even though the roads were a little bit dicey when we went to bed last night, thank you that we have a good group of people here to worship you and a good group of people online as well. And I pray that our worship would be honoring to you today. I pray that what we say and what we do here at this church would be fruitful and beneficial for us as we figure out what it looks like to follow you in the world in which we live. I pray that these sermons and these words will be helpful to us as we see where the rubber meets the road and figure out how it is that we are called to follow your son Jesus as people who believe in Jesus. So again, I pray this time would be honoring to you and helpful for us. Lord, thank you for Sunday morning. We love you. We ask this all in Christ's name. Amen. So don't worry about what other people think. This proverb has a certain rebel without a cause appeal to it. It sounds romantically defiant. There's a certain charm to the attitude that, you know what, I'm just going to be me, and if you don't like it, tough. This may be expressed in other forms as well. Other sayings make the rounds that communicate this same basic idea. There's the tried and true, "Only God can judge me," which seems to be used most by those who have the least amount of faith that one day he actually will. There's also the very Instagram-friendly, one of my personal mantras, "Dance like nobody's watching. Dance like nobody's watching." And then there's the brash, "A lion does not concern himself with the opinion of sheep." Though I would argue in the Bible that sinners like us are compared a lot more to helpless sheep than we are to strong and independent lions. But whatever form it takes, does this idea that we shouldn't worry about what other people think of us square with biblical wisdom? Well, in some ways, yes, it does. And in other ways, no, it doesn't. There's certainly truth to the idea that Christians should not live for human approval. In the Old Testament, God's law called God's people to a radically different way of life from that of the surrounding nations. In their religious practice, their civic rules, and their moral code, Israel stuck out significantly from those around them. And that was not a coincidence. It was by design. In short, God's people were called to be different, not to fit in for the sake of approval or acceptance. If anything, God's people got themselves into trouble when they cared too much about what other people thought of them and tried to be more like them. We see the warning issued in Deuteronomy 12, starting in verse 29. When the Lord your God cuts off before you the nations whom you go in to dispossess, and you dispossess them and dwell in their land, take care that you not be ensnared to follow them after they have been destroyed before you, and that you do not inquire about their gods, saying, how did these people serve their gods? That I may also do the same. In 1 Samuel 8, the Israelites demanded a worldly king. And part of the reason for it is that they wanted to be like the nations. They started caring more about what people thought of them than what God had commanded of them. That's a temptation that we all wrestle with from time to time. In the New Testament, Jesus makes it clear that following him is not the path to human applause. In Matthew chapter 8, verse 20, Jesus warns a potential disciple that foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. In Matthew 10, he tells his disciples in no uncertain terms that following him will lead to suffering. They'll be delivered to courts, flogged in synagogues, dragged before rulers, and even betrayed by their own families. They will live on the run, shunned by the world. So if you really care about what other people think of you, if you are desperate for approval, if you hunger for validation in the world's eyes, then following Jesus is not for you. The same theme runs throughout the rest of the New Testament after Jesus' death and resurrection. In Acts chapter 5, verse 29, the apostles are arrested for preaching the gospel, but they proclaim, "We must obey God rather than men." In Galatians 1:10, the apostle Paul reminds his audience that he's not seeking man's approval, he's seeking God's. And if he was trying to please men, the last thing he would be is a servant of Christ. And then in Hebrews 10 and 11, the author recalls how his readers, who were suffering in the present, also suffered in the past, and assured them that they follow in the footsteps of the faithful before them. Disciples of Jesus have a better possession than worldly comforts or human approval. So in that sense, we do not care what other people think of us, even if those other people make our lives harder out of opposition to our faith. You know, Christianity has not always been popular throughout history. In our earliest days, Christians were regarded as those who held to dangerous superstitions, the way some Romans put it. Christians were accused of crimes they didn't commit. They were rumored to be seditious, untrustworthy, and evil. A Roman by the name of Lucian once condescendingly referred to the earliest Christians as poor wretches. Poor wretches. The point is that the earliest followers of Jesus weren't winning popularity contests. If they were trying to gain public approval, it didn't always work. Likewise today, when denominations, when churches, when pastors, when individual believers try too hard to win the approval of the world, even if our intentions are good, we're just trying to be relevant, we're just trying to meet people where they are. If we try too hard to win the approval of the world, we inevitably end up compromising, weakening, and ultimately dying in our faith. As Jesus said, man cannot serve two masters. So yes, there is clearly a sense in which we do not care, as Christians, what other people think about us. We do and we say what is good, what is true, what is beautiful in God's eyes, regardless of how it looks in the world's eyes. We hold beliefs. We maintain practices about God and humanity and our world that many may find strange, annoying, offensive, or even dangerous. We hold those lines even if it makes us stick out. We hold those lines even if we're alienated. And we hold those lines even if it means we have to suffer. Because when push comes to shove, when we're forced to choose, we must obey God rather than men. We care more about what God thinks of us than what other people think of us. But how does this proverb fall short? What are the potential problems of Christians not worrying about what other people think? Well, the truth is that Christians should worry about what other people think of us, especially two main groups. First, we should worry what other believers think of us. We should care about the opinions those inside the church have of us. In 1 Corinthians 5, a man has committed an egregious public sexual sin. And this man had no sense of shame whatsoever. No sense of responsibility. No sense of remorse for his actions at all. And what made it even worse was that his brothers and sisters in Christ, well, they didn't care either. They either approved of what he did or simply turned a blind eye to it. So Paul commands these believers to take action against this sin in hopes of restoring the man. But Paul warns them that if they don't take a firm line, that sin may be normalized or condoned or even encouraged among others. One bad apple can ruin the whole cart. Paul goes on to acknowledge in 1 Corinthians 5, verses 9 through 13, that in a way, Christians are in no position to police the activities of those outside the church. We shouldn't be shocked or surprised when sinners sin. We shouldn't be shocked or surprised when non-Christians live like non-Christians. But within the church, we do have a responsibility to judge each other. We hold each other accountable for sin. We call each other to repentance. We urge each other on to live as the holy people God has graciously declared us to be. In a very real way, we Christians ought to care what our fellow believers think of us. In 1 Corinthians 8, Paul addresses a debate about whether or not Christians could eat meat that at one time had been involved in a pagan religious ceremony. Some Christians thought that it was totally fine. Those gods were frauds anyway. And technically they were right. Meanwhile, other Christians felt that eating that food would be a sin against God and would violate their conscience. So Paul argues in verses 8 through 13 that, okay, Christian, if you think it's fine to eat that meat, go ahead. But be aware that other believers may be watching. And understand that your actions could pressure them to do something they consider to be sin. Thus, you make yourself a stumbling block to them. And in Paul's words, by your knowledge, this weak person is destroyed, the brother for whom Christ died. He even adds that in treating your fellow believer this way, you sin against Christ himself. All because you insist on doing what you want to do without a care in the world of what other people think or how it affects others. As a believer in Jesus, you are part of a community. You are part of a family. That family is the church. And in the church, your words, your actions, your example, and your attitude are not just about you. You can help or harm brothers and sisters in their walk with Christ by how you speak and how you live. So we should all care deeply about what our fellow believers think. Paul puts it this way, Romans 14, verse 19. So then let us pursue what makes for peace and for mutual upbuilding. In short, it's not all about me. Romans 15, 1 and 2. We who are strong have an obligation to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Let each of us please his neighbor for his good to build him up. So first, we care about what our fellow believers think of us. Second, we care about what non-believers think of us. Remember what we said about the Old Testament law that God gave Israel. It was meant to set God's people apart from the surrounding nations. Well, in a way, it was also meant to make God attractive to those people. The idea was that the distinctiveness, the oddity of these Israelites was intended to invite people into this new way of life. God's people weren't called to be weird in a defiant, defensive, bunker mentality, us versus them sort of way. They were called to be weird in an appealing way. We see that in Deuteronomy chapter 4, starting in verse 6. Moses says to the Israelites, "Keep them and do them," referring to God's commands, "for that will be your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the peoples, who when they hear all these statutes will say, 'Surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people.' For what great nation is there that has a God so near to it as the Lord our God is to us whenever we call upon him? And what great nation is there that has statutes and rules so righteous as all this law that I set before you today?" Again, their weirdness would draw people in. Jesus picks up on the exact same idea in Matthew chapter 5, starting in verse 13. He says, "You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet." Again, we're supposed to stick out. We're supposed to be different. Verse 14, "You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." We live the life that God has called us to, knowing that an unbelieving world is watching what we say and what we do. And we strive to live in a way that is so undeniably different, so undeniably better than what this fallen world has to offer, that sinners find themselves strangely drawn to it. They see our good works. They see how we live. They see how we speak. And they find themselves glorifying our Father in heaven. Again, this theme carries on throughout the New Testament. In Acts chapter 2, while the early church was a nuisance or a threat in the eyes of some, it also grew in favor with many others, to the point that it was expanding daily. The early Christians' love for each other had an impact on what non-believers thought of them. And God used that to change those people's minds. to soften those people's hearts, and ultimately to save them. This is what's often referred to as our public witness. We Christians care what non-believers think of us in the sense that our examples of holiness, our credibility, can be a tool in God's hand to save sinners. 1 Peter 2:12 says, "Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation." Let your holiness do the talking, so that those around you, even if they oppose you now, are eventually proven wrong and come to glorify God. The Apostle Paul certainly cared about what non-believers thought of him, and he cared about what they thought of the whole church. In 1 Corinthians 6, he rebukes two Christians stuck in a legal dispute. And part of the reason why Paul was so frustrated that these two Christians would take each other to court in front of non-Christians was because it made the church look bad, and thus it hurt their mission. These non-Christians who were trying that case may look at these two believers bickering and determine that, you know, there's nothing really special after all. There's nothing really different after all about these people's faith. And there might not be anything really all that special or different about their God either. Paul hated that thought. To get an idea of Paul's passion, look at 1 Corinthians chapter 9, starting in verse 19. He says, "For though I am free from all, I have made myself a servant to all, that I might win more of them. To the Jews I became as a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law I became as one under the law, though not being myself under the law, that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law I became as one outside the law, not being outside the law of God, but under the law of Christ, that I might win those outside the law. To the weak I became weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that by all means I might save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, that I may share with them in its blessings." And then verse 31, 1 Corinthians chapter 10. "So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Give no offense to Jews or to Greeks or to the church of God, just as I try to please everyone in everything I do, not seeking my own advantage, but that of many, that they may be saved." Paul cared what other people thought of him, to the point that he would happily make personal sacrifices and would happily give up personal freedoms if he believed it would bring more people to faith in Jesus. People being saved mattered more to Paul than him getting to do what he wanted to do. 1 Timothy 3 outlines the qualifications for leaders in the church, and one of Paul's requirements of an elder is that he be well thought of by outsiders. We Christians care about what non-believers think of us, because they're the ones to whom we've been sent with the message of the gospel. So like all the others we've covered, there's both good and bad with this problematic proverb. We Christians do not care what other people think to the point of idolizing popularity. We practice our faith no matter what the world thinks, without compromise, even if we're alienated, rejected, or persecuted for it. But we do care what those inside the church think, because we are a community, a family who can help or hurt each other with our words and our deeds. And in a way, we care what those outside the church think, because God has sent us to them. And we don't want our conduct to damage the attractiveness and the credibility of the gospel. At the end of the day, it's true that we live for God's approval, not man's. But when we can, we strive to be in good standing with men and women. We strive to be good neighbors, good citizens, good co-workers, good classmates, all for God's glory. Pastor and theologian John Stott once wrote that the church is called to a double identity. On the one hand, the church is called out from the world to belong to God and to worship Him. But on the other hand, the church is also sent out into the world on its mission. We're both called out from and sent into. Some have put it this way, that the church is against the world for the world. We are against the world for the world. We're against the world in being honest about sin, refusing to participate in it, and warning it of God's judgment. But we're for the world in announcing the gospel to it and calling our hearers to repent, believe, and be reconciled to God through faith in the broken body and shed blood of Jesus. We invite the world into this salvation that we've been given through Jesus Christ. We invite the world into this good standing we have with God, secured for us through Jesus' death and resurrection. We invite the world to discover what we already know to be true, that what truly matters in eternity is not what men or women think of you, but what God thinks of you. And our only hope of God thinking good of us comes by faith in His Son, Jesus Christ. So may we live against the world, not caring what they think, for the sake of the world, that they may come to know our Savior and Lord. Let's pray. Father, thank you for again, this day, this opportunity to worship you. Thank you for your word that ultimately is the centerpiece of what we do here and what we say here. Thank you for your word and what it teaches us, and that it teaches us not just about who you are and what you've done for us, but it teaches us the proper response to who you are and what you've done for us. And so, Lord, I pray that you would help us live out that proper response in the world in which you've put us. That we would be faithful to you, regardless of how strange or different or odd it may seem to other people, but that we would also live on mission to them, that our weirdness, our strangeness, our holiness, our sticking out as salt and light in a world of blandness and darkness, I pray that that would ultimately draw people to you, that you would use our examples, use our lives, use our words to save sinners. So Lord, again, help us not care too much about what other people think of us. Lord, remind us that what you think of us matters most, and you think good things of us. You think of us as your children and your servants if we believe in your Son, Jesus Christ. And if that's what you think of us, then that's what we really are. And for that, we worship you, we thank you, we praise you, and we rejoice. We love you, we thank you, we ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together as we sing.
Oh, and you are the Lord. Oh, has no sorrow.
Service for this morning. Again, thanks for being here in the room. For those who couldn't make it out on the roads, well, hopefully they're melted by now. Hopefully we won't have any issues getting home, and we will see you next week, but thanks for joining us online. Again, if we had to sum up the sermon today, it would be, we don't care what other people think because we're called to be different from the world, set out from the world, and if that makes us unaccepted, then so be it. But there's another sense in which we are sent into the world. We are representatives of Christ, and so in that sense, we do care what people think. We don't want people to think poorly of our God because of the things that we say or the things that we do. So again, we're called out from the world, but also sent into the world, and that's something for all of us to remember in the week ahead. So with that, I'll close our service in prayer. If you have questions about who we are, questions about what we do, questions about Jesus, or if you just need someone to pray with you, by all means, let us know. But for now, let's close in prayer. Father, again, thank you for this day. Thank you for all you've given to us. Thank you for your son, Jesus. Lord, thank you for calling us out from the world by your grace, forgiving us and adopting us as your children and commissioning us as your servants and giving us something far greater and far better to live for than worldly approval. But Lord, we also embrace our mission that you have sent us into the world to represent you, to tell people the good news of Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, I pray that you would help us to do that in the week ahead with courage, with boldness, with wisdom, with sound strategies, so that, as Paul said, we might win some through our examples and through our words. So, Lord, again, I ask that you watch over this church in the week ahead. Help us all to glorify you and bring us back here safely to worship you again a week from now. We love you. We ask this all in Christ's name. Amen. Have a great week.